Sì, online. Maybe. Mi sentite? Avete? Sì? Siete collegati? Sì?
Sì, la sentiamo, prof.
Ok, so let us start from what we did yesterday. So we were discussing the equation of diffusion, and the last thing that we were discussing was a little example. Is a simple example because we have a general. So let me recall which is the point. We solve this equation for the moment using the Fourier decomposition, and the difference respect to what we did the lessons before is that the coefficients depends on time. Okay, it's not terrible. Let me remind which is the crucial part of this technique. We have to use as a basis eigenfunctions of the differential operator, the time-independent differential operator, this one. Eigenfunctions will satisfy the same boundary conditions as the problem. Okay, this is crucial. And assuming that we know these eigenfunctions, after it is relatively straightforward, because we can write an ordinary differential equation for the time evolution of the coefficients. And in simple cases, in which, for instance, this Cn is the expansion of f of a not homogeneous term, and in simple cases, this equation provides a simple solution. For instance, this one, which correspond to the cases in no, but it's rather general. This one actually is rather general. Okay. So, in order to use this approach, as I said many times, we need to be able to determine the eigenfunctions. If we are not really able to do that in a simple way, this approach is not effective. So, we were discussing a little example, and now we will look at it more in details. The example is an example in which f of x is equal to zero, therefore f of x, recall again, is the right-hand side of the equation, is the not homogeneous part of the equation. Therefore, if it is zero, cn is equal to zero, and this solution becomes simple, becomes this object. Okay. And what we were discussing is the behavior with the time evolution of a solution. So I would say the best is if we look directly to the little code in Python. By the way, sorry, I substituted already the code of yesterday with a better one, and I can put now on that page the new codes that I wrote. Let me just do that a moment. So this is called Google Class, no? Okay. I think I already substituted, actually. Let me put the new codes that we discussed today. Okay, so this is the new version of example 520. And let me add a couple of new codes, the 6.1 and 6.3. Okay, here I have to write something else, example 6.1 and 6.3. Okay. After I show you what I did with the 520, but let's go ahead with The example that I want to show first is the sixth one. This one. Okay, so this example. Sorry. This example here is the one that we started discussing yesterday. Let me run the code that we can see. So the example corresponds to an initial condition, which is this 5 - 1/5 absolute value. And it is essentially this blue curve that you see here. This is the initial condition at time t equal to 0. Okay. So what we do here is extremely trivial. Okay, first of all, we want to plot these things. So as usual, we go from having defined a function to having defined this vectorized function. Let me remind you again why it is useful to introduce these vectorized functions, because in this way we avoid having to write loops. We just do in one line. No? First, we define an array that contains, for instance, 101 points, numbers uniformly spaced between 0 and 50. And after we compute the value of psi using the vectorized psi in each of these points, but we do this just in one line. Actually, from what I understand, this I mean, I've not yet checked, there is also another advantage in going to these vectorized functions, that the Python numerical code is faster. I think it is faster because there is it's partially compiled, the code at that point. I think probably you understand what I mean. If you have a Fortran code or a C code, you know that the first step that you do is to compile the code, meaning that you are assigning to each of the variables some explicit type, a certain length even. So the code at that point can run very rapidly because the computer has not to spend time and continuously checking how much space is needed for a certain variable. It's defined at once forever. And if I understand correctly, when we use this NumPy, numerical Python routines, like for instance vectorization, if I understood correctly, Python runs a little bit faster because there is a sort of partially compiled the code. I mean, it knows already which is the space that needs to be allocated. For instance, it knows that this is an array having a certain size with certain slots which are numbers, etc. So in this way, the code is slightly faster. Python is not very fast. If you try to run some of the codes you have already seen, that is certainly not very fast. But still, we can use it for our purposes. So okay. So here essentially is how to produce this blue line, which is the initial condition. And after, what we need to do is very simple. We have to decompose this initial condition onto the basis. So which basis is here? These are the elements of the basis, our sinus function. Notice that also here I'm using this NumPy, whatever it's called, sinus. Okay, these are the sinus of even the pi, the 3.14, blah blah. I use the NumPy here. Okay. So these are the elements of the basis, sinus of n pi x divided by l, and l is 50. At that point, we will have to project the psi function here on each of the elements of the basis. And to project means that we compute the product and we integrate the product from 0 to L. Okay. And to do that, you know, these functions are extremely simple. So with Mathematica, it was possible to do this analytically. I think that probably part of this can be done analytically even using Python, but I'm not so sure how much of it. So instead of trying to do it analytically, I did it numerically. So I used Quad, which is our simple routine for computing an integral, and therefore I am integrating this quantity, so which is the product of the initial condition onto the elements of the basis, and I am integrating this psi 1 here from 0 to L, and as you recall, I have to tell what other quantities to say are not integrated, which value I have to take. So the other quantity inside psi 1, there is x and n, and so I am telling that I integrate on x and instead n is n. Okay. So I am defining a string, an array of values which are the projections of the initial condition of the elements of the basis. I decided to plot all these numbers for a simple reason. Here. So these are, you see these numbers here, these are the coefficients of the projection of psi on the basis. And there is something that one can easily notice. There are four columns. So recall that the way by which Python is evaluating this thing is that it always starts from zero, okay? It always starts from zero. So the first object here corresponds to n equal to zero. And of course it is zero, because if I put zero in sinus of n pi, of course I get zero, okay? And after the next one, this one is actually sinus of pi x over 50. And if you think a moment, okay, I did not plot, but it is essentially something like this, okay? Sinus has no nodes, only in zero and in 50. And this one is the next sinus that would contain one oscillation and so on and so forth. So what I want to stress here is that of these four columns, there is this column here and this column here, which are providing numbers which are significantly different from zero. Why? Because they are different from zero. But the other two columns, here we read something as 10 to minus 15, and this is essentially zero. And the reason why it is essentially zero, it is because we have an object which is that absolute value, blah, 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 which is totally symmetric respect to 25, okay? And if we integrate that object with a function which changes sign respect to 25, respect to the central point of the interval, that integral goes to zero. Sort of parity, if you like. It's parity respect to the center of the interval. So these two columns here, which are 0, 0, 0, are indicating essentially that they correspond to Bn, which are zero for parity. Okay, the first one is zero for trivial reason, because it is zero, okay? But the other are zero because of parity, if you like. But the other numbers are not zero. Another thing that we can notice is how fast or not fast these coefficients are decreasing, okay? So I've not checked, maybe you can try to check, but you recall the little discussion that we had. The function that we are projecting has a discontinuity in the first derivative, no, located here. And therefore, these Fourier components should decrease as 1 over n squared. I suggest you could try to check if it is true. I mean, you just take these numbers, this bn, and you make a plot of the bn, and after you, maybe the best is if you make a plot in log scale, because at that point the slope gives you exactly the exponential, no, of if I go down as 1 over n power alpha, the slope is alpha. Okay, so maybe you can try to check, just to play a little with these numbers. You can plot the numbers which are not zero, so the numbers of these two columns, and you should see if they go down which slope. They should go down with a slope of the order 1 over n squared because of the presence of this singularity. Okay, so after what? After this equation was extremely simple. You recall that, where it's gone here, the time dependence is just this, okay? So I just copied this, without pretending to do anything. I just incorporated in the code this time dependence, and I did it like here. Okay, k n square, pi square, and this is time. So the coefficients depend on time, and I put another label to recall, okay, which of the coefficients depend on n. And at that point, we have our solution. Our solution is, okay, you can build it as a series. So you start from zero, you initialize, and after you start adding, solution is solution plus the next term up to a maximum value that I decided to call n top. Notice that here I computed n max coefficients. I mean, there are other ways of writing this, not necessarily the best way, but okay, it works anyway. And okay, and after I plotted a few things. So what did I plot? The first graph here corresponds to plotting the solution at different times. So the blue line is at time equal to zero. The other are at time equal to 20, 40, and 60. Certain units that depends, we have to check. This was an explicit problem with iron bar, specific eta, blah. So these are seconds, I think. What is interesting here? The interesting thing is that you see that almost immediately, this discontinuous behavior disappears. And it disappears, I mean, the solution becomes immediately very regular, for the reason that I was mentioning yesterday. The reason is that the coefficients with n large are suppressed. I mean, the coefficients, they behave as exponential of minus n squared. So if I have to represent that discontinuity in the first derivative that is present at t equal to zero, I had to incorporate components of the Fourier with very large values of n, because it goes to zero relatively slowly. But after, with the time evolution, immediately these components with relatively large n are suppressed, and therefore this discontinuity is immediately washed out. Okay. So this we see from here. And another thing that we can notice is how few terms are needed to converge. So here I plotted at time equal 20, What I get if I include, you recall that vsol, okay, vsol is just this vectorized form of sol. Sol is the solution. And the solution, okay, depends on x, of course. I not to use t here, that is horrible. This is actually the array of the positions, it's not of time. Next time you will change the name of this array. So the first is the position. Inside t, actually, there are all the x0, x1, x2, blah, blah. The second is time, that is 20. And the third argument is the maximum value of n, that, or I in this case, that I use in this sum. So if I put 2, consider that the first term is 0, and so the second, I just use one contribution. Okay, if I put 4, since again this is 0, I'm actually using 2, 3, and 4. And what we notice, so this is what we get if we just use one component. Notice that this is exactly that sinus I was speaking about before. And this is exactly sinus of pi x divided by L, the blue line. And so this is what happens if I just put one component in the Fourier analysis. If I put two, I go to the orange. The orange already looks quite similar to the solution. And then you see that there is a very, very rapid convergence towards the solution. Okay. And of course, again, this is due to the fact that even for at t equal to zero, the convergence is not good. I mean, it goes down as 1 over n square. But if time is finite, I mean, after t equals 0, after t equal to 0, whatever, there is another factor which is suppressing all of these coefficients, which is an exponential factor. And that exponential factor is extremely effective at canceling contributions with n larger than the minimal. The minimum n needed to describe a solution. Is it clear enough, this point? Because as I said already yesterday, this is an important even conceptual point, because after it's linked to the fact that equations of diffusion cannot be really solved going backward in time, okay? Okay, if this is clear, if this is clear, then we can discuss another little point, which is also quite interesting conceptually. So the next point that I want to discuss with you is the following. Is the following. Let's have a look here to the solution of the equation that we have been discussing. And what we can notice is that in principle there were a lot of coefficients. I mean, this was a specific problem. This was, let me read, which was the real problem we are discussing. It was an iron bar, okay, an iron bar with long 50 centimeters. So there, this iron has of course a specific heat, which is the C, a specific density, which is R, the rho, and a thermal conductivity, which is K. Okay, so if we look back to the numerical code, somewhere here, I wrote these numbers, okay? I wrote these numbers here, a certain moment, okay? But if we look to the solution, we notice that these numbers enter all together, so to say, to form a combination, okay? So the crucial idea is the following. In principle, we have an equation that contains a lot of dimensional quantities. And it is possible, under certain conditions, to rewrite this equation in a form in which whatever quantities entering the equation is dimensionless, meaning that I have absorbed into the definition of the various variables their own dimension. I mean, simple case, here I had a bar having a length L, and L can be measured in centimeters, okay? But I can immediately slightly change, telling instead of referring to a specific bar having a length of 50 centimeters, let me take the X, the position inside the bar, divided by L. So at that point, this new quantity is dimensionless, okay? And of course, X, instead of going from 0 to L, will go from 0 to 1, okay? And similarly, I can do for the time. If I can find a combination of the parameters in the equation, which has the dimension of a time, then I can take the time, measured in seconds, and divide it by that combination, which has the dimension of time, to provide again a quantity which is dimensionless. Notice that we know that this is possible just by looking, for instance, to this equation, to the solution of this equation. Because here we have, for instance, these exponentials. And of course, unless we have done some horrible mistake, whatever is at the exponent of an exponential should be dimensionless. You recall this is something that I think is you learned the first years, because of course if you have exponential of x, you can expand. The exponential of x is 1 plus x plus x squared, x cubed, blah blah blah. So if x was not dimensionless, that quantity would have no proper dimension. I mean, would just be completely meaningless. So it means that this exponent must be dimensionless. And this means that we have a time, t, and therefore all what remains here must have a dimension of 1 over time. Okay? So, okay, n is dimensionless, is a number, pi is a number. So essentially from here we already can notice that evidently k divided by rho c l square must have a dimension of 1 over time. And this is easy to check explicitly because let me just show you, because the dimension of rho is, let's say, gram centimeter cube. The dimension of C is not the velocity of light here. C is this heat capacity. Is a unit of energy. The book is using joule. Doesn't matter. But it's energy divided gram and units of the temperature. After we have this thermal conductivity K, which is again energy, joule, divided time, seconds, centimeters, and again this K. And finally we have L, which of course is centimeters. And therefore, if we put together rho C L square divided by K, we should end up, this is a 3, eh? We should end up with just seconds. So what I'm claiming is that the dimension of rho C L squared divided by K must be seconds. Okay, this is the idea. You can check, but this obviously is like this. So what's the point? The point is we can rewrite the equation and the solution, of course, in terms of this dimensionless quantities. So instead of going, instead of using x and t, we can substitute with x divided by L, and let's call this quantity y. And instead of t, we take t divided by that combination that I wrote a moment ago. Let me just rewrite it here. It was, I think it was rho c L squared divided by k. And we call this quantity s. So we know that y and s are, let's say, L0, meaning that, okay, dimensionless quantity. So at that point, we take one of our equation we started from. Our equation was, where is it going? I lost it. Okay, let's say, is this equation here, and in particular, f was equal to zero. Okay, and we can rewrite this equation in terms of the new variables. So in terms of not x and t, but y and s. And if we want, I don't know if it is particularly useful, but in principle, one can even say that the new solution, I mean, the old solution was u of x and t, and this corresponds to a new solution V written in terms of Y and S. So V is the solution written in terms of Y and S, if you like. So you can check, it's extremely trivial. You start from the equation for U, and for V, you get the following equation. Derivative of V respect to S minus second derivative of V respect to y square equal to zero. And okay, you have similar relation for the boundary conditions. So why is this very useful actually? For two different reasons. The first reason is that, for instance, if I make this little effort, in this case it was, of course, very easy. In other cases, maybe one has to work a little more. But let's say in this case, it was easy to notice that this combination here, rho c L squared added by k, must have a dimension of a time. So this means, essentially, that it provides us which is the natural time scale onto which measure the time evolution. Because of course, a priori, I don't know, I mean, I have my object which is evolving in time, even just a simple problem like this one. Let's say a problem in which I have an object cooling down, for instance, but on which time scale is it cooling down? Seconds, hour, years, giga years. Okay, it depends, of course, on the property of the material, for instance, and how big is the material and all that. And it is easy, therefore, to understand which is the relevant time scale just through a dimensional analysis. What we have done here is what is called dimensional analysis. So we have defined now a quantity which has the dimension of time, and we notice that we can, so to say, get rid of the dimensions by going from T to S, and therefore we get a problem which is dimensionless, and in that way we know, okay, the typical evolution of time is regulated by this unit of time that will depend on the problem, but is immediately possible to tell. Okay, this is one of the advantages. The other advantage is that if I solve this equation here, the equation written in terms of dimensionless quantities, then I have solved all problems similar to this one. If I need to change, I don't know, the length of the bar or the material of the bar or whatever, of course I can just use this general solution. And after, before, when I go back to the original variables x and t, of course I use this relation here where I put the right numbers, okay? But I don't need to solve again the same problem. I have solved once forever, and after I just use the scale down solution to get the fully dimensional solution. So this type of dimensional analysis is extremely useful. And if you have to solve problems similar to this one, I mean problems in which you have, for instance, a time evolution of a system, really the very first thing that you should do is to understand which is the proper time scale of evolution of a system. Because instead, if you just run a numerical code, you can get literally whatever, in the sense that if the object has a time scale of, let's say, 1 hour, if you run it for 5 seconds, you will see no evolution. Or if you run it on a time scale of 1 year, that immediately the solution would go to the asymptotic one. You will not see any transition, let's say. So this is really very important message. When you want to solve a problem in which you have, for instance, a time evolution, first of all, check which is the proper time scale. Actually, this is even more general. If you have differential equations in which you have dimensions, the first thing you should do in general is to try to get rid of how many dimensions as possible. Sometimes it's possible to eliminate completely, sometimes in part, but every time that you are combining the various dimensional parameters into something which is dimensionless, you are simplifying significantly the problem. Okay? So this analysis is strongly, strongly advised. Okay, so after this, let me discuss another little problem. Another little problem is how do we solve problems in which we have Dirichlet but not homogeneous Dirichlet boundary conditions. So recall that we discussed this problem in the case of time independent equations. So let's discuss, provide one example of what you do in the case in which you have not homogeneous boundary conditions, so inhomogeneous boundary conditions in this diffusion equation, okay? And we are still solving this, of course, using the Fourier analysis. So it is rather simple because we can use the same technique essentially that we used before, but it's better to discuss at least one example. So suppose that we have an equation which is totally similar to the one we discussed a moment ago, this 6-1, okay? So it's the same problem, but now I impose not homogeneous, inhomogeneous boundary conditions. So it's the same problem, meaning that, let me write your problem, is again rho c du over dt minus k second derivative of u respect to x square equal to zero, okay? And again, we are between 0 and 50. It's the same bar, okay? What we change is that the initial condition This time we choose 4. Before it was that spiky thing, if you recall. So it's a constant in this case. And the boundary conditions are at 0, still 0, but at L, so 50, it is 4. Okay. So notice it's a little bit strange problem if you think a moment. Strange, I mean. The problem is like this, no? You have at the very beginning, suppose that this is, for instance, heat. At the very beginning, it is like this, no? The temperature. If you put here the temperature, this is 4. But notice the boundary conditions on the right hand side here. We are still imposing that it remains up to 4 for all t. This condition here. But the other condition is funny because it tells that for every time it has to go to 0. So this could correspond to the idea that you have your bar that is at the beginning at a certain temperature, and instantaneously you put one side of the bar in contact with a heat reservoir at a temperature 0. Okay, so it is clear that this can cause some little trouble. Okay, because you have an initial condition which is 4, and you are trying to force the problem to jump instantaneously to 0. Okay, but it's not big troubles. So how do we solve this problem? Essentially, we solve the problem as we did before by shifting the variable. So instead of solving the problem for this u, which has this not homogeneous boundary conditions, as usual we introduce a simple function that satisfies the two boundary conditions and is annihilated by this differential operator. So if I choose, let's say, a function p of x equal to 4x divided by 50. So of course for x equal to 0 is 0, for x equal to 50 is 4. Okay, just a straight line. Okay. And what happens? It is linear, therefore it is annihilated by the second derivative. And this time independent, therefore is annihilated by the derivative respect to time. So this means that I can go from u to v, and I define a v of x and t, which is equal to u of x and t minus p of x. So if I do this, it is clear that the equation for v remains the same equation, because I mean the differential operator is just completely annihilating p, but I am changing the boundary conditions and also the initial condition, the initial value, because of course the boundary conditions for v becomes 0 and 0, because u had to be 0 at x equal to 0 and p is 0, so 0 minus 0 is 0. But at the other extreme, u had to be 4 minus 4 and it is 0. So it is clear that v of 0 and t is also v of 50 and t and is equal to 0. Concerning the initial value, of course, is different, because the initial value cannot be anymore 4, it will be 4 minus p of x, okay? So my v of x t equal to 0 will be equal to u of x t equal to 0 minus p of x. So it's 4 minus 4x divided by 15. So at that point, I solved the problem for V using exactly the same code as we did before. I get V, and recall that U is V plus P of X. So the solution is not what I'm getting by solving the problem for V, but is that plus P of X. Okay, and this is what I've done in this little example here, the 6.3. So let me run again the code. Run. Okay, so this is very squeaky, this table. Okay. Let's start from this. So what I have done is exactly what we are discussing, in the sense that okay, as I just mentioned, what changes is the initial condition. It's no more 4, it's 4 minus that function p of x, 4 minus 4, etc. So I have to expand this object here, okay? So notice that this object at x equal to 0 is equal to 4, and at x equal to 50 is equal to 0. Okay, so that is where you say we can expect to have some little trouble, because this psi of x does not respect the same boundary conditions of the basis. But we already know that this is not a big problem, because we will not get a convergence, a point-like convergence, but we will get a convergence in norm, and that is enough, okay, to solve the problem. So what I did after is exactly the same, it's the same code. I just project the psi onto each of the elements of the base. I must have defined it somewhere, These are the elements of the base. So I project, meaning that I multiply, and after I compute this integral again, exactly as before. And recall this zero that I put here after quad is because this routine quad provides an answer to numbers. They estimate the value of the integral and the error bar. But the error bar we are not going to use, so I just take the first of the two numbers, that is called zero in Python. And the rest of the program is essentially just the same. I have just to do what? This is again as before. These are the coefficients giving the time dependence that we obtained analytically. Okay. And the solution, therefore, can be written by summing together the bi, which are essentially the expansion of the initial condition, times the time dependence of this coefficient, times each of the elements of the base. After I have done that, I have still to sum p of x. So the solution that I got up to this point here would be the function v, and to v, if I want the u, I have to add p of x, which is 4x over 50. Okay, so let's see what we get. So this first graph here is what happens. So again, it's horrible, I have to change the name. T is not the time, t is various points between 0 and L, and 20 or 40 or 60, 60 is a time instead, and 30 corresponds to the maximum value of n of the element of the basis. Recall, no, recall nothing, because here there is no symmetry, so all the elements of the basis are different from zero. So 30 is rather a large number. I am adding together 30 contributions, okay? And here we see the time evolution after 20 seconds, 40 seconds, 60 seconds. So it is quite clear. We have our bar that was initially at this temperature 4, and we put in contact with an object having temperature, source of heat at temperature 0, and it starts cooling down. And at the very beginning, of course, it was a sort of step function, but after it starts moving the cool area, the area 0 degree, towards the right. Okay, it's evolving like this. The other graph is instead showing that this time the convergence is not exceptional. Why the convergence is not exceptional? Exactly because that B of X was very irregular, because you recall in the example before, Psi was irregular in the sense that it had a discontinuity in the first derivative. But here we have a discontinuity in the function itself, no? Because we are going from an object which has a certain value 4, we are expanding that object on a basis that is vanishing at x equal to 0, not 4. So essentially, you can rephrase that telling that you are expanding a function which jumps from 4 to 0 at a point, okay? And of course, the convergence is horrible. It converges as 1 over n, not really very very good, so to say. Of course, still, what saves us is the fact that we are studying the equation of diffusion. So if t is not equal to 0, then on top of that 1 over n, there is the exponential of minus n squared that is killing systematically the other terms. Still, you see that the convergence is okay, but not exceptional. So if we compare with the previous example, it's no more here, but you recall probably. In the previous example, after including a couple of elements of the base, already we were very close to the solution. But it's not really the case here. The blue line corresponds to including just the first element, and the second one, the orange, and includes this includes already two terms, because two really means two, means 0 1, and the six includes six elements. So you see that even with six elements we have some fluctuation, and only including 10 and after the red is 30, I think we get the smooth behavior that you have seen when we were including 30 elements. Okay, so it converges, but it's not very fast, for the reason that I said. The point is that we have put this object in contact suddenly with something having zero temperature, and we are expanding this object in such a way that, I mean, one side was 4, but the side is 0, and so we are using our basis function, which is 0 and 0, and we are forcing the object to make a jump in the value, and that is the origin of the relatively slow convergence. Questions concerning this? Is okay? Fine. So if this is okay, then we can discuss a couple of other arguments. One is rather short and the other a little longer. Okay. So, could even put a nice diffusion Fourier. Okay, let me add something. Let me call this separation of variables. cannot read here, separation of variables. Very good. Okay. So, what are we going to discuss? You have already solved a partial differential equation. You have solved the Schrödinger equation, time-dependent Schrödinger equation in particular. But even the time-independent Schrödinger equation, I mean, in three dimensions, you have to separate, you have x, y, and z, or you have r, theta, and phi, etc. But as you recall, you were never really using the techniques that we discussed here. Well, in part you were, because you were expanding, for instance, you were doing a Fourier analysis, that you were doing, in the sense that you were expanding the solution on a basis which were the eigenfunctions of the time-independent problem, so on and so forth. But in general, you were obtaining that type of result using a technique that is called separation of variables. Now I will revisit very rapidly the separation of variables just to compare with what we have done. So the crucial point is that the technique of separation of variables is very easy and very fast to, but it works only in a very limited subset of cases. In particular, it works only if your equation is homogeneous. So f of x must be equal to zero. So for instance, you have used the technique of separation of variables to obtain the bound states and the time evolution of the bound states. Okay. But you cannot use that technique if you want, for instance, to study scattering. Because if you want to study scattering, typically you are providing to the system something which is the initial wave function. You want to study the time evolution of your wave function, but you are providing the system with something which is the initial shape of a wave function. You are, for instance, telling that initially it was a plane wave, blah, 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 blah. And after you want to see what happens to your plane wave through the process of scattering. So typically the equation that you are solving when studying scattering, so when studying states of the continuum, significantly different respect to the equation that you solve for the bound states. You recall the main differences are the equation for the bound states is an homogeneous equation where you have the energy as an eigenvalue, but if you are instead looking for solutions of scattering, the energy you choose, to tell yourself which is the energy at which you are making the process of scattering. And the equation is not homogeneous. It contains typically an initial wave function, which is the solution at time equal minus infinity. Okay. So what I want to say is that sometimes you can use this technique of separation of variables, but it's not the most general of the possible techniques. So let me just revisit very, very rapidly in one case so that we can compare essentially. When we can use this technique, essentially this technique becomes very similar, identical to the technique of Fourier. Okay, so let's go back to this example here. So rho c the u over the t minus k second derivative of u respect to x square equal to zero. Okay. And what? And okay, as usual, we have u of x t zero equal to psi of x. psi of x, sorry, and homogeneous Dirichlet u0 t equal to 0 equal to u of L and t. So in this case, we have an homogeneous equation, homogeneous boundary conditions. We easily solve this by separation of variables. The technique is the one that you have already seen, so I can go very, very fast through it. Essentially, what you do is that you write your solution u as the product of two objects. Let's say a function big X that depends on X, and a function big T that depends on T. Okay. So at that point, you substitute inside your initial equation. And of course, what you get is, okay, rho C. In the first case, the X, the big X, just steps out. And therefore, you get the derivative of T respect to T. Okay, and this is equal to K. And here is the big T that steps out. And you get the second derivative of x respect to x. And at that point, you just divide by xt. And typically, you put some minus sign everywhere, because after it is easier, put minus sign everywhere. And so what we get is minus rho, oops, minus rho c 1 over t dt over dt, and this is equal to minus k 1 over x dx over dx. Okay, and therefore the crucial observation here is that this quantity here depends on time, but not on x. This quantity here depends on x, but not the second derivative, sorry. Depends on x, but not on time. This means that both of them must be equal to a constant. And we call this constant lambda, the famous separation constant. And therefore, we are back to two independent equations. We have an equation, let's say this one, it can be written as minus k, second derivative of x respect to x squared equal to lambda x. And the other equation is minus rho c, derivative of function t respect to time equal to lambda t. And of course, I imposed these conditions here. Okay. So this is what I need for the equation for the time evolution. And these are the two boundary conditions that I'm going to use for the equation for the space dependence. So here and here. So essentially, it means, for instance, that x of 0 is equal to x of L is equal to 0. And therefore, what happens is that I solve this equation here. But we know how to solve this equation. This is an homogeneous equation with this Dirichlet homogeneous boundary conditions. The solution for these objects are some x equal to phi n, or called whatever we want to call them, called xn directly, this better. Where this xn of x are our usual sinus function, sinus of n pi x over L. And also, we know that lambda is the eigenvalues eigenvalue, and the eigenvalue is k n square pi square divided by l square, and we can call this lambda n. Okay, so this is the solution of this problem here. You get this. At this point, lambda is determined. Okay, we use one of the lambda back into our problem, and so we are left with our minus rho c dt over dt equal to this lambda nt. And from here we get an exponential, of course. So the exponential that we are getting is tn of t, which can be written as an integration constant, bn, which is where we are going to use the initial condition. Notice we have used here and here the boundary conditions. The two boundary conditions are the ones which are imposing the fact that we have sinus, okay, sinus of n pi x over l. We have not yet used the initial condition. The initial condition will end up into this coefficients bn, and we have therefore bn exponential of minus lambda n, and this is some t minus t zero divided by rho c. Okay, so everything now is essentially set because we know that we have obtained a complete set of solutions, because this sinus constitute a basis. So whatever function can be expanded on this basis, and we know the time evolution of the elements of the basis, because it is given by this evolution here. And so in conclusion, we can write whatever function u of x and t as a superposition sum from 1 to infinity of this bn sinus of n pi x over l exponential of minus lambda n t minus t zero divided by rho c. And lambda n is what I wrote here. And if you compare, of course, you get exactly the same quantity that we got before. Okay, so finally, how to fix our bn? Well, of course, we know that u of x and t zero is psi of x, but for t equal t zero, this can also be written as a sum from one to infinity of bn sinus of n pi x divided by l, and therefore exactly as before, bn will be 2 over l, the normalization, the integral between 0 and l dx of psi of x sinus of n pi x divided by l. Okay, so conclusion. We have checked again that in certain cases we can solve this type of partial differential equations with the technique of separation of variables. But this technique works essentially when, for instance, f of x is equal to zero, because instead, if f of x is not equal to zero, if f of x is also possible to factorize, I think that in that case probably it would still work, but for a generic f of x you cannot. Okay, so it's not the most general technique, but in certain cases it can be applied. If it can be applied, it's very easy, and you go back to a Fourier decomposition, because what you are getting
is again exactly the eigenvalues of the time-independent operator, and so you are back with a Fourier decomposition. Okay, so just to put things, so you have a technique which is a little bit more general, the Fourier decomposition. If you are able, as I said many times, to obtain the eigenfunctions, then you can solve essentially whatever problem, because you expand also f of x, for instance, in terms of those eigenfunctions. Okay. Of course, it implies to compute after a few integrals and blah, 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 blah. But, okay. And there is an even simpler technique, the one that you just discussed, but this technique works in a limited number of cases, and when it works, essentially provides back the same type of solution of the Fourier decomposition obtained very, very rapidly. Okay. But as we know already, there are situations, complete situations, in which it is not easy, or I mean numerically difficult in any case, to obtain the eigenfunction, so we will have to resort to the numerical techniques that we started discussing and we are going to see in the near future. Okay, last topic, if you have questions on this, is okay. I mean, we have seen, by sure, this, and it's simple and interesting. So the last problem of today is to start discussing, instead of Dirichlet boundary conditions, the Neumann boundary conditions. And the reason is that they are conceptually slightly different than Neumann boundary conditions. We are going to see why, and I think next time we are also going to see that there is something special, so to say. Okay, let me add here something which is Neumann. Neumann still for the diffusion. For diffusion. Well, okay. So the problem that I want to discuss, as I said, is the problem of our equation of diffusion, but this time imposing the Neumann boundary condition. Recall that the Dirichlet are boundary conditions in which you are telling the value of the function at a certain point. The Neumann, you're telling the derivative of the function. So let's write explicitly our problem. So we have rho c, the u over the t, minus k, second derivative of u respect to x squared, equal to f of x and t. And okay, the initial condition, psi of x, but okay, oh, this is the hybrid case. No, skip this, sorry. Okay. Okay. Okay, sorry. Oh, okay, fine. And the Neumann conditions, let's say, are the u over the x evaluated at x equal to zero equal the u over the x evaluated at x equal to L, and suppose that they are homogeneous equal to zero. Okay, so this is what we want to discuss. And okay, just a second. Okay, so we have this. think that we need to discuss. The first thing that we need to discuss, but I think that we did not discuss before. Now I'm not 100% sure, but I think that we have not done, is the time independent differential operator under Norman boundary conditions. So what happens essentially if we study an operator like minus second derivative of u respect to x square with u prime equal to u prime equal to zero. So not the value of a function, but the derivative of the function equal to zero. Okay, so there is a difference respect to the Dirichlet boundary conditions. And let's try to get this as rapidly as possible. So the conceptual difference is the following, that in the case of the Dirichlet boundary conditions, so if I was putting here u of zero equal u of L equal to zero, and suppose that I am trying to get the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions, so derivative of u respect to x square, let's call the eigenvalues theta square, okay, theta square u, okay. So if I was imposing the Dirichlet boundary conditions, I know that there is not a solution, there is not a solution with eigenvalue equal to zero, in the sense that the solution with eigenvalue equal to zero is just the trivial solution u equal to zero. But in this case, in the case of Neumann boundary conditions, I can notice that if I use a function u equal to constant that in principle is different from zero, then I am satisfying the two boundary conditions, the Neumann boundary conditions, and I am satisfying this equation with theta equal to zero. But the solution is not identical to zero. In the equivalent case with the Dirichlet boundary conditions, it would correspond to the case u identical equal to zero, because in the case of, let me just put this as a sort of note back. Okay. For Dirichlet, so u of zero equal to u of L equal to zero. Okay. If I try to solve the same problem under these conditions, what happens? That I get solutions of a form sinus of n pi x divided by L and eigenvalues lambda n equal to n squared pi squared divided by n squared, no? It's correct, no? Yeah. And the case n equal to zero corresponds, so these are the un, let's say, corresponds to the case u identical equal to zero. Okay, so in the case of Dirichlet, I don't have the eigenvalue zero, because the eigenvalue zero only corresponds to the null solution. But in the case of Neumann, the eigenvalue zero exists, because I have a non-trivial solution u different from zero, which is the constant solution. So I have to incorporate. So this corresponds to the fact that the space of the solutions include this non-trivial zero space, meaning that there is, as I said, a solution with eigenvalue equal to zero that is not identically zero. Okay, so this makes some difference, as we are going to see next time, also today, but better next time. Okay, so the case of Dirichlet boundary conditions, the zero space is essentially empty, contains only the trivial solution u equal to zero. In the case of a Neumann, not. It contains this non-trivial solution u equal to constant. So how are written for the solutions of the Neumann problem? Okay, so we have to separate this special solution, the solution with theta equal to zero, which is a constant, from the other solutions. Okay, it is trivial, I will skip this little detail, it is trivial to check that the solutions satisfying this boundary conditions are cosinus functions. So it is clear again for Neumann now, okay, Neumann, but the solutions must be of a form, let's say, un equal to some cosinus of alpha x, and moreover, cosinus of alpha l has to be equal to zero. Okay, and therefore, from here, we can claim that alpha l must be equal to n, minus sinus of alpha l, and therefore alpha l is equal to n pi. Okay, so this is so u prime of n evaluated at L is equal to minus alpha sinus of alpha L, and therefore alpha L must be equal to n pi. Okay, now it's written properly. Okay, so our eigenfunctions are this, okay, I did call before theta actually this quantity, so sorry again. And therefore our eigenfunctions are cosinus, and let's call these quantities, call these quantities gamma. I don't know exactly why, but this gamma n are the eigenfunctions. Gamma n of x are therefore cosinus of n pi x divided by L, and the corresponding lambda n, exactly as before, are n square pi square divided by L squared. Notice that here n is running from 1 to infinity, but we also have the gamma zero, which is essentially a constant. Okay, we can for instance choose gamma zero of x equal to 1. That is what we would get if we take the gamma n of x and put n equal to zero, and the corresponding lambda zero is equal to zero. Okay, there is a little difference in the way we deal with gamma n, with n equal 1, 2, etc., and the gamma zero. The little difference is in the normalization. Because if you make a scalar product, if we take, let's say, gamma n, gamma m, okay, we are already they are already orthogonal. So this is equal to zero if n is different from m. And instead, if we take gamma n for so the same, what we get is L half for n equal to 1, 2, etc. But if we take gamma zero, since gamma zero we have chosen 1, we just get L. So we have just to be slightly careful, because when we will expand everything in this base, the normalization of the term zero is not the L half, or better 2 over L, but is L, better 1 over L. Okay, so what remains to be done is essentially just to check that also in this case we can obtain, also using this Neumann boundary conditions, we can obtain an equation for the time evolution which is essentially identical to the one that we obtained before. So let me do this rapidly, because there is not too much to say. First of all, so the idea is that we have this base of objects that contains one, gamma one, gamma two, etc. So all together they constitute a basis, and we can expand everything on this basis. So we can expand, our equation was this one, so we can expand, of course, f, psi, and we need again to check how to expand the equation itself, derivative respect to time and the second derivative respect to space. It's essentially identical with what we did before, so let me just redo this, but rapidly. And so okay, the solution. Okay, the solution can be written in this form. So u of x and t, we are going to write as b0 of t plus sum from 1 to infinity of bn of t cosinus of n pi x over l. So this is of course essentially identical to what we did before, but before we did not have a term like this, which is x independent, and we had a sum on sinus functions. Okay, of course this term here, which is x independent, makes some difference. Okay, so in principle, how do we determine b0 and bn in terms of the solution? Just projecting. So in principle, b0 of t, recall that normalization is not L but one over not L half but L, so we divide by 1 over L, the integral from 0 to L of our solution u of x and t, the x, and similarly bn of t is equal to 2 over L integral from 0 and L of u of x and t, and here we have a cosinus of n pi x divided by L the x. Okay, so we are trying to solve our equation, this equation here. Which way? We have found which are the eigenvalues and eigenfunctions of the time independent differential operator, our cosinus function, and the zero function with eigenvalue zero. So we expand everything on that basis, and therefore our solution
here is expanded on this basis. This gamma 1, gamma 2 are the cosinus objects, okay? And, okay, let's do this little step. What are we going to obtain? We project our equation again on this basis. So let me just repeat this rapidly. For instance, if we take the term containing the derivative respect to time, we can project that term, meaning that we do 2 over L, the integral between 0 and L, of du over dt, and the cosinus of n pi x over L dx. But of course, we just exchange the derivative and integral, and we get derivative respect to time of 2 over L, the integral of u of x and t, cosinus of n pi x over L dx. But now, if you just compare with the line above, this quantity here is, of course, bn. And so all this is dbn over dt. So this is what happens if we project the term containing the time derivative. What happens if we project the term containing the second space derivative? We get the eigenvalues. So if we do exactly the same, if we do exactly the same trick, so we can, let's say, do minus, the equation was minus k, no? What is going, oops. Yeah, minus k second derivative, sorry. So we can do exactly the same. We can write minus k 2 over L, and here we have integral between 0 and L. And here we have a second derivative of u respect to x square, cosinus of n pi x divided by L, integrated the x. And what we can do is to perform twice the partial integration. Let me just do maybe this that can be useful to do once. So we integrate this and we get minus k 2 over L, the u over the x, cosinus of n pi x divided by L, computed between 0 and L. And after we have a minus here, the minus of the partial integration, and a minus because we are deriving the cosinus. So we get a minus k. When we derive the cosinus, we also get an n pi divided by L integral, 2 over L still, integral between 0 and L of the u over the x sinus of n pi x over L dx. Okay? So what we notice, this term here is equal to 0. Why is equal to 0? Because the u over the x is equal to 0 at the two extremes, because these are the Neumann boundary conditions. So this object here is 0 because of the boundary conditions, the u over the x equal to 0 to the two extremes. So we perform again a partial integration. And therefore, we integrate again this, and we are getting minus k n pi over L, 2 over L, u sinus of n pi x divided by L, computed between 0 and L. And now we have a minus sign, the minus sign of the partial integration, so we get a plus k, we derive this, so we get n pi divided by L square 2 over L the integral between 0 and L of U, and we get the cosinus of n pi x divided by L dx. And this time this is 0 because of the sinus, so because of the basis that we are using. We are using a basis of functions whose first derivative satisfies the same Neumann conditions. So this is again 0. So also here we see that it is absolutely crucial that we expand the solution on a basis satisfying the same boundary conditions. And finally, we are done because this object here is our eigenvalue that we computed before. And so what we are getting is essentially k lambda n, and this object here is the projection that we did call bn, I think. No, yeah, bn, we did call it bn. Okay, so we have projected the term containing the first derivative respect to time, the term containing the second derivative respect to space. We can, of course, project the f of x. We call Cn was coefficients, and okay, let me just proceed relatively rapidly through this. Maybe it's better if I write still. I mean, f of x and t in principle is a x independent term c0 of t, which corresponds to what I am doing when I am integrating on x with the gamma zero, which is a constant, plus a sum from 1 to infinity of the cn t, and here I have again cosinus of n pi x over n. Okay, and this c0, c1, c2, cn I know how to compute. Again, I just project on the basis of blah, blah, blah. Just keep this little step. And we can therefore put everything together. And the everything together tells us the following. Tells us, what tells us? Strange enough, it's not written. But, okay, it tells us the following. So, okay, we have the time derivative term projected contains the dbn over dt. So, okay, maybe it's better if I write it, just a second, let me just write it. So, I get something as the zero order term. Okay, here we have done for n equal 1, 2, but exactly identical thing, I would get db0 over dt. So essentially what I would get is a db0 over dt plus the sum from 1 to infinity of dbn over dt cosinus of n pi x over L. This is what I get. There's a minus sign, isn't it? No, there is no minus sign. Sorry. No, there's no minus sign. So this is what I get from the first term. And there is a rho c in front, but I was forgetting, of course. Rho c. Written somewhere. Rho c. And after, there is the other term, which contains instead k, which is the coefficient. And here I get essentially the b0. But notice that the b0 is equal to 0, because the b0 contains the eigenvalue. Oh, where is gone now? Sorry. We computed this projection, but this projection gives us
lambda n bn. And if I put b0, I have to write lambda 0. Lambda 0 is 0. So actually this is b0 times 0. So this goes to 0. Plus, instead, I have the other terms, which are sum from 1 to infinity. And I have lambda n, and I have bn, and I have the cosinus, again, of n pi x divided by L. And this is equal to f of x and t, which is what I wrote above. Okay, let me just copy it. It's c0 of t plus the sum from 1 to infinity of cn t cosinus of n pi x divided by n. Okay. So this is our equation projected on each of the elements of the basis and rebuilt. Okay. And of course, since we have a basis, we know that the only way by which we get, I mean, I can take this and put on the other, on the left hand side, I put this is equal to zero. And so I know that if I have something, linear combination of the elements of the base, and this is zero, the only possibility is that the coefficients of the elements of the base must be identically zero, all of them. So it means that I get zero for all the coefficients multiplying the elements of the base, including the zero term, okay? So it means that I get the following equation. For the zero term, it is rho c dB0 over dt. I don't have this term here because there is a zero, and this is just equal to c0 of t. While for all the other terms, I get rho c dbn over dt plus this object here, so plus the k that I was in front, the eigenvalue that is written there, so it is k pi n over L squared. And finally, I have bn of t, and this must be equal to cn of t. Okay. And this is what I have to solve. This is what I have to solve. And as usual, I am going to solve this set of ordinary differential equations. For each of them, I will use as initial condition the one that I get by expanding the initial condition that I called psi. Yeah. So I can write that, go back here. So if I work with u of x and zero, this is psi of x, but again, my psi of x can be expanded. This expansion is called b0. Okay, so this expansion I get from the expansion of the u evaluated at t equal to zero. Okay, so okay, let's put this here at t equal to zero. Let me see which is the best way of doing this. Okay, let me call this expansion d. Sorry, I think it's best is this following. I call this d zero. Okay, I call this d zero plus a sum on n from 1 to infinity of the dn cosinus of n pi x divided by L. But at that point, I have to compare d this expansion here is the expansion that I have written here a moment ago. And therefore, this provides me the initial condition for each of the P0. I mean, what I need to solve this equation, the C, I know, I have determined. So these are all first order differential equations. And each of these first order differential equations, the integration constant, the initial value, is what I obtain by this expansion. Okay. Okay, so this is what we are going to discuss in next lessons. We are going to discuss a concrete example of what happens using this Dirichlet boundary, Neumann boundary conditions. Okay, was it clear enough what I said? It was okay. Fine. Questions from home?
No.
Okay, so as usual, try to play a little with the numerical codes that I put. Maybe, as I said, try to check the behavior with n of the various coefficients to understand if it is true or false. That is a rather general argument that if you have a discontinuity in the function, the convergence is low. Just one over n. If it is the first derivative, it is continuous, is one over n squared, and instead in general is one over n cubed, and so on and so forth. And okay. Fine, then have a nice end of the week and see you next week. Ciao, ciao.
Grazie prof, buon weekend, arrivederci.
Arrivederci.
Ciao, ciao, ciao. Ok, it's going to be closed, it's going to be closed. Let's see. Stop presenting, and here, stop recording.